This video is a screen capture of an online text-to-speech service I used to facilitate the first chapter of the book Fundamentals of Audio Production by McDaniel, Shriver, and Collins. It has a 2008 copyright, which makes it on the old side, but in looking for a course audiobook, it appears to be a viable textbook in use today. This video is for Chapter 1, Sound and Its Nature. As a student in this class, you may question, why is it necessary to learn about sound? Well, if this class sparks your interest and you do well with the assignments, you may choose a college or career path in the field of mass communications. That is to focus primarily on working with film, television, photography, radio, and graphic. Oh wait, that's what I studied 40 years ago at Chico State. No, now it would be similar, but all digital, not analog. There is video, photography, and graphic arts, but it's all facilitated with computers and online resources. And broadcast television and radio is a dying form of commercial entertainment. Your future will be informed and entertained by online and streaming services. However, the physical world is still the physical world. When people speak, sing, and play instruments, we all produce analog sounds. The physics, the physical laws of science, will always exist. The only things that have changed since the day of Edison, Bell, Marconi, and other pioneers of communication are the recording and editing devices. If you want a career in communications, you will need to know many scientific fundamentals if you want to appear capable and intelligent. So please enjoy this video and the other videos I have linked to this assignment.
Fundamentals of Audio Production. Chapter 1. Sound and Its Nature. Most audiobooks begin with a discussion of sound, what it is and how it moves under different conditions. The authors of this text believe that understanding the nature of sound is fundamental to the processes of controlling, capturing, storing, manipulating, and reproducing audio properly. Students of audio sometimes struggle to comprehend the physics of sound, whether represented acoustically or electrically. For many, the easiest understanding of such concepts comes from visualization. If one can picture an idea in the mind's eye, it can be readily understood. Toward that end, many authors begin their discussions by invoking the visual metaphor of the sound wave type. Ickley depicted as the familiar sinusoidal, or sine, wave, figure 1.1. Frequently, the sound wave is likened to the waves in water that emanate outward when a pebble is tossed into a pool, or the wave-like manner in which a stretched spring transmits a vibration. And while either of these similes offers some insight as to how sound travels in space, neither really describes adequately what occurs when sound is produced in an enclosed, three-dimensional space. Sound from molecular motion. This discussion will emphasize an alternative view of sound waves. The basis of sound is vibration. Whether those vibrations emanate from the vocal folds, the strings of a violin or piano, the reed of a saxophone, or the head of a drum makes no practical difference. Furthermore, sound is transmitted, or travels, as a kind of vibration. A proper view of the behavior of sound in the enclosed space of a studio, for example, rests on visualizing molecular vibrations and how they emanate from a sound source. Sound moves through the air by setting up variations in the density of air molecules that constitute vibrations. Air in a room is composed of molecules that are actually spread about sparsely, with space between individual molecules. These molecules are constantly in motion under the influence of minute temperature changes, wind currents, gravity, and other forces. If molecules were enlarged so that they were visible to the naked eye, one would see that even in a quiet, empty room, molecules are in non-stop motion, as if the air were fluid. Physicists explain that we are all immersed in an ocean of air molecules. And while those air molecules do have mass, NLC level exert considerable weight on us amounting to 14 pounds and 70 pence per square inch, we are not conscious of this. People literally swim through this sea of air molecules unmindful of the effort required. If a person were to speak in this room filled with air molecules, the pressure of the air waves emanating from that person's voice would be enough to move the molecules nearby. These molecules would bump into the molecules next to them, and those molecules would bump into those next to them, and so on. Until finally the air molecules adjacent to the listener's ear would receive this vibration and exert pressure on the tympanic membrane eardrum. This phenomenon is illustrated in Figure 1.2. A more detailed explanation may help clarify the process of molecular displacement as sound travels in air. When a person speaks, as just described, some air molecules around the speaker are compressed. The compression wave of air molecules moves away from the speaker by being pushed into the next layer of air molecules. Naturally, this is a three-dimensional process taking place in a three-dimensional space. To oversimplify somewhat, slight changes in air pressure caused by speaking move air molecules immediately surrounding the speaker. As noted, when this first layer of air molecules is displaced, they will bump into the molecules adjacent to them, thus causing them to be displaced. But as pressure returns to normal, the first layer of air molecules returns to its original place. This bouncing back, or returning, of the air molecules produces a sharp reduction in their compression. This condition is called rarefaction. Therefore, the transmission of sound through air takes place by means of the slight movement of molecules. Air molecules vibrate in place, bouncing back and forth, as tiny changes in air pressure cause them to first become compressed together, then to rarefy by spreading apart. It is from these progressive molecular movements, emanating outward from a source, that the notion of a sound wave can be applied. The vibrations move in a wave-like fashion, as molecules ever farther from the source bounce against each other, as suggested in Figure 1.3. Here is where the ripples and a pool comparison may be instructive. As a person walks through a room, the body's movement creates waves and eddies in the air mass, as it would in a pool of water. If one imagines living in an ocean of air that acts in a fly-like manner, it should be possible to visualize the waves that wash through this imaginary ocean. When a person speaks, vibrations of the vocal folds create regular variations in air pressure that radiate outward in waves in all directions, just like ripples in a pool. The expenditure of energy is another factor that plays a key role. Energy is required to do work. Because air molecules have mass, as they are compressed, energy is spent in moving them. This part of the process is referred to as the amplitude phenomenon as the kinetic torr known as Newton's cradle, shown in Figure 1. 5. When one ball is put in motion, one ball will bounce away on the opposite end of the cradle. Put two balls in motion, and two balls will be displaced, and so on, regardless of the number of balls that are put in motion at one end, that same number will be displaced on the opposite end. In the same way, the magnitude of molecular displacement near a sound source will proportionately displace the molecules at a distance, although the displacement will be attenuated because sound is dispersed as it moves away from the source. In addition, owing to the mass of the molecules, energy is consumed in the processes of attenuation. The farther air molecules are from the source, the less energy there is available to move them. This is because the number of molecules that need to be moved increases as the sound wave travels farther and farther, causing a decline in the energy available. The result, amplitude declines as the listener moves away from the sound source. Move sufficiently far from the sound source and there will no longer be enough energy to move air molecules to produce perceptible sound. In the fields of audio and acoustics, the standard unit of measure of amplitude is the decibel, commonly abbreviated as decibel. The decibel, which is defined as 1/10 of a bell, is sometimes identified as the smallest change in loudness that a trained ear can detect. In reality, most listeners are unable to detect changes in loudness smaller than 3 decibel. Unlike the hertz, which is an absolute measure, acousticians customarily use the decibel as a relative measure, in describing differences in loudness. For instance, if a sound is boosted 6 decibel, the sound after boosting is 6 decibel louder than before. The human ear does not have an unlimited capacity to respond to sound amplitude. Excessive volume can permanently damage the delicate mechanisms in the ear that transmit the small molecular vibrations through the auditory canal. This is a fact that audio producers should always be conscious of. Excessively high sound pressure levels impacting the tympanic membranes can severely damage hearing. The effects of reduced air pressure on ears are well known to anyone who has flown on an airplane. In some ways, high amplitude sound levels have similar effects. As the airplane rises, pressure levels drop, causing passengers to sense the change as pressure in their ears, sometimes quite painfully. The dynamic range of the human ear is generally considered to be about 120 decibel, For this reason, 120 decibel is often called the threshold of pain, and this is the amplitude at which irreparable or permanent damage begins to occur. Concertgoers sometimes experience a ringing in the ears after exposure to high sound pressure levels, an indication that the sound pressure levels were at or near the threshold of pain. Sound wave propagation. The phrase speed of sound is a commonplace expression. In the jargon used by acoustic specialists and sound engineers, the term velocity is often used to describe the speed at which sound waves travel. Use of this term carries with it the risk of confusing the principles that underlie the way that sound behaves because, as has been emphasized, sound does not really travel. Instead, waves of varying densities of air molecules move through layers of adjacent molecules as they respond to the energy supplied by sound sources. Nevertheless, there is a definite and measurable speed at which these vibrations are communicated, and it is possible to determine with accuracy just how long it takes for the vibrations at the sound source to reach some distant reception point. Say, one's ears. Because the ambient density of air molecules varies slightly with altitude, the velocity at which sound travels varies a little with altitude as well. For the sake of simplicity, acousticians normally consider the speed of sound at sea level approximately 1,130 feet per second sufficiently accurate to be used in making calculations. This figure is called a constant, even though minor variations occur as barometric pressure and altitude change. This amounts to roughly 770 miles per hour, which is what aeronautical engineers and pilots call Mach 1.0 speed. Sound timbre. Sounds that are produced by musical instruments are quite unlike the pure note of the sine wave mentioned earlier. The sounds of musical instruments, like most natural sounds, tend to be highly complex. By complex, it is meant that such sounds contain overtones and harmonics that color a sound. Overtones and harmonics give a sound its characteristic timbre or tone color. These overtones and harmonics are additional frequencies that accompany the fundamental or dominant frequency of a sound. In the previous example, a piano note of 440 Hz was mentioned, a note known as concert A. The sound of this note, when played on a piano, contains not only the 440 Hz fundamental F dot frequency but also harmonics made up of multiples and submultiples of 440 Hz. The frequency of 440 Hz is dominant, but the note will also contain harmonics at 220 Hz on half the dominant, or the second subharmonic, 880 Hz, double the dominant, 1320 Hz, three times the dominant, 1760 Hz, four times the dominant. And so on. Overtones result from frequencies whose interplay produces tones at the sum or difference of those component frequencies. For example, 440 Hz and 220 Hz might interact to create an overtone at 660 Hz. Harmonics and overtones occur at much lower sound pressure levels than the dominant frequency, but are a critical part of the piano's timbre, and their interactions may produce overtones of their own. A change in frequency that is either one-half or a double the dominant frequency is known as an octave. Thus, 880 Hz is one octave above 440 Hz, concert A. A note at 220 Hz is one octave lower than concert A. Similarly, 1760 Hz would be one octave above 880 Hz, or two octaves above concert A. This relationship, the octave, is one that most listeners can detect as something special. Even persons who are musically untrained recognize that the two notes are somehow related and congruous, even if they cannot describe their relationship. The concept of octaves as a way of describing relationships among frequencies comes into play often in the fields of audio production and acoustics, psychoacoustics, and the principle of equal loudness. The objective study of how sound waves behave, especially in enclosed spaces such as rooms and halls, is known as acoustics. The more subjective study of how sounds affect humans, or how human brains interpret sound, is called psychoacoustics. Currently, some areas of inquiry in psychoacoustics include how locations of sounds are detected, how pitch is heard and perceived, and how the ear separates complex auditory signals occurring simultaneously. Research in these areas has practical implications for certain aspects of the audio field, such as improving spatial imaging and managing digital file sizes. Harvey Fletcher and Wilden Munson of Bell Laboratories conducted some of the pioneering research in psychoacoustics in the 1930s. Their studies led to the publication of what has become known as the Fletcher-Munson curves, a set of graphs that visually demonstrate the principle of equal loudness. Fletcher and Munson's work was refined and extended in 1956 by D.W. Robinson and R.S. Dadson, and subsequently defined by the International Standards Organization in 2003 in ISO 226. Despite the later work, most audio practitioners refer to the graphs as the Fletcher-Munson curves, figure 1.6. The principle of equal loudness as represented in the Fletcher-Munson curves describes the human ear's frequency response curve, as standardized through a series of widely administered listening tests. Acoustic specialists know through these tests that the human ear is most responsive to frequencies between 1 kHz and 6 kHz. They also know that a human's ability to hear frequencies below 500 Hz falls off steeply. The ability to hear frequencies above 7 kHz falls off too, but somewhat less sharply. The Fletcher-Munson curves are referred to as equal loudness curves or contours because they illustrate that in order for listeners to perceive all frequencies as equally loud, the amplitude of frequencies outside the mid-ranges, roughly 1 kHz to 6 kHz, must be increased. In other words, listeners must boost the bass and treble portions of the audio spectrum to make those frequencies appear equally as loud as mid-range frequencies. Frequency and temporal masking. Another imperfection of human hearing is its inability to distinguish and process the whole harmonic content of a highly complicated auditory signal. There can be so many frequencies present in complex sounds that the ear tends to distinguish only dominant ones. This is because dominant frequencies tend to mask weaker frequencies. This well-known and frequently studied phenomenon plays an important role in certain techniques used in the audio field. Two kinds of masking have been identified, frequency masking and temporal masking. Frequency masking occurs because of the ear's limited ability to simultaneously process sounds of multiple pitches. To oversimplify slightly, a loud, 1000 Hz, tone will have a tendency to mask a softer, 500 Hz, tone, so that the ear will not detect the lower frequency. Frequency masking is fundamental to the processing of digital audio and in designing transducers and converters for low bandwidth circuits and storage. Because it is known that the ear does not respond to all the frequencies in a full bandwidth signal, some lower amplitude elements of the signal can be removed, and the ear will not perceive the loss. Masking simplifies digital audio file compression. A compression algorithm eliminates the low-level sound components in order to shrink file sizes. This can be done because engineers know listeners would not really hear them anyway. By this means, it is possible to reduce data rates in digital storage and transmission systems, making file sizes more manageable. More on this will be provided in a later chapter. Masking can also hide background noise in an audio recording or public address system. Analog tape is thermal noise from an amplifier. And electrical noise interference are often present but disappear from perception when a moderately loud sound begins. Listeners hear only the intended signal because their hearing no longer discerns the masked noise sounds. Temporal masking refers to the phenomenon in which the human ear has difficulty hearing a soft sound that follows a loud sound closely in time. Research on this subject has shown that the ear's recovery time is typically about 5 milliseconds. Moreover, strange as it may seem, pre-masking causes the ear not to hear a soft sound that immediately precedes a loud sound. This knowledge, too, is applied to the development of data conversion schemes in order to reduce the size. Another application of research into the masking phenomenon is noise masking. This research has shown that noise is a powerful masker. The ear brain will focus on the white noise to the exclusion of other low-level sounds. For example, conversations from adjacent office spaces. Some sound companies have developed noise masking systems, which are purported to foster greater privacy through the use of either white noise or pink noise. These noises resemble the sound of rushing wind or water. Noise masking systems usually involve a series of speakers placed above suspended ceiling systems. The speakers produce relatively low-level noise that is evenly distributed across the office area. Still another area of psychoacoustics research is the study of how individuals localize sounds in space. The brain constantly makes calculations based on the short delays between the times when sounds arrive at the left and right ears. A sound originating to the left of the listener arrives at the left ear a few microseconds before arriving at the right ear, partly because the sound has to travel a slightly longer path, and partly as a result of the shadowing effect of the head. The brain takes that very short delay, term the interaural time difference, into account when locating the sound to the left of the listener. The brain also factors in the relative amplitudes of the sounds, termed the interaural level difference, as the shadowing effect of the head will also lower the amplitude of the more distant sound and introduces some comb filtering. Finally, a frequency filtering scheme compares the frequency content of the sounds arriving at the two ears. The body of research that has grown out of the investigation of sound localization suggests that the frequency and the complexity of the sound, meaning its harmonic content, play key roles in the ear's ability to locate the sound source. Generally, very low frequencies and very high frequencies are more difficult to localize. Research into spatial localization has its practical application in the development of surround sound and virtual reality audio. Knowing which cues the brain relies on to localize sound allows sound designers to prepare soundtracks that manipulate sounds so that they appear to originate from intended points in space. Acoustics. A knowledge of how sound travels allows acousticians to design environments that permit control over sound characteristics. For example, one of the first problems that must be solved in designing a studio space is keeping unwanted sounds out, and at the same time stopping sound from traveling out of the studio space or into adjacent studio spaces. As already noted, sound can be thought of as a product of molecular vibration, since acoustic energy can only be transmitted through such motions. Achieving acoustic isolation from this point of view simply becomes a matter of stopping those molecular movements. Once defined this way, acoustic isolation translates into a mechanical problem that can be solved using well-established methods. The two simplest techniques for discouraging vibrations of air molecules are to dampen them with something of great mass, or to mechanically decouple adjacent surfaces so that they cannot transmit the vibrations. Understandably, materials and objects exhibiting great weight are difficult to move or vibrate. Imagine a gigantic boulder, something at least the size of a large house, and then imagine what would happen if a person tapped on one side of that boulder with a rubber mallet. It would be unlikely that someone on the other side of the boulder could feel the tapping. The mass of the boulder would dampen the vibrations completely. This is the principle behind creating studio walls that are constructed of thick cement, or concrete blocks that are filled with cement. The walls become so massive that they do not transmit sound vibrations well, and serve instead to block the passage of acoustic energy. Creating such massive obstacles introduces considerable expense. So, acoustic isolation frequently requires a compromise between cost and acceptable attenuation. Another, somewhat less costly method for discouraging sound transmission involves disconnecting, or decoupling, adjacent surfaces. Studio designers sometimes describe this technique as building a room inside a room. Using this method, walls are constructed of double sets of staggered studs. The double studs effectively disconnect the inside walls from the exterior walls. The technique is made more effective by adding several layers of drywall, adding mass to the studs and filling the wall cavity with acoustic insulation, figure 1.7. A second floor is floated on top of the building's subfloor. The floating floor sits on spring-loaded or rubber shock absorbers that prevent vibrations in the studio from being transmitted through the floor to adjacent areas. A second concern in designing studio space is managing the movements of sound within the room, or the reflection of sound waves within the enclosed space. This usually entails some type of surface treatment. A fundamental rule of studio design is to avoid parallel surfaces. This means that opposing walls should not be parallel to each other, and, ideally, the ceiling should not be parallel to the floor surface. This will discourage room resonances that can be created when standing waves are set up. Standing waves are sound waves that reflect off a surface in such a way that they either interfere with or add to later arriving waves. As a reflected wave arrives at the primary wave, it may be combined in the way that it is 180 degrees out of phase, which causes it to cancel out, or it can be 360 degrees out of phase, which reinforces the primary wave. Waves that are 180 degrees out of phase will be in opposition and will result in lowered volume at the resonant frequency, while waves that are 360 degrees out of phase will be in phase and cause the resonant frequency to be louder than others, figure 1.8. Such standing waves are set up when a sound wave bounces between two parallel surfaces. Standing waves are particularly problematic at the frequencies where the length of the wave is equal to the distance between the two surfaces, or is a multiple of that distance. For example, if a room is 20 feet long, A sound wave whose length is 20 feet long from crest to crest will set up standing waves. Similarly, wavelengths of 10 feet and 40 feet could also be an issue. So it is vitally important to design a studio space where length, width, and height of the room are not the same dimension or multiples of each other. To understand this better, try to calculate the resonant frequency, or mode, for a room. To do this, first calculate wavelength. This is a relatively simple mathematical operation, described by the formula. Wavelength equals velocity 7 frequency. Recall that sound velocity is a constant that at sea level is 1130 feet per second. To solve for a 60 Hz frequency and AC power hum, for example, simply divide 1130 by 60, which will yield a result of 18.83 feet. A sound wave at 60 cycles per second would exhibit a length of 18.83 feet from crest to crest of the sound wave. By inference then, if the distance between studio walls were 18.83 feet, there would likely be a danger of setting up standing waves in the room when a 60 Hz sound filled it. The 60 Hz tone then would appear louder than other frequencies, or lower in volume than other tones, depending on the phase characteristics produced by the sound source. If the length and width are both 18.83 feet, the risk is magnified further. The following formula calculates the frequencies that might cause resonance problems in a given space. Frequency equals velocity 7 length of room dimension. Using 1130 feet per second as the speed of sound once more, the mode for a room that is 20 feet long can be determined by dividing 1130 by 20. TLE resulting quotient, 56. 5 Hz, is the frequency at which problems with resonance or phase interference can be predicted. Because the interference may occur at harmonics of the fundamental, one might also expect problems at 113 Hz, 226 Hz, 452 Hz, and so on. If this hypothetical room had a ceiling height of 10 feet, it is even more likely that a serious potential problem will exist, i.e. 1137, 10 equals 113 Hz. This is because the second harmonic of the room length, 56.5x2, 113 Hz, is the same frequency as the fundamental of the room height. Arranging studio walls so that they are not parallel will discourage these reflections, standing waves, and undesirable room modes. Additionally, careful attention to room dimensions during the design phase will help avoid other acoustic problems. It often happens, however, that the space to be used as a studio is already constructed and may be subject to problematic room resonances. Or the room may be too live, or reflective of sounds, and yield excessive reverberation. In this case, the designer must turn to surface treatments to minimize those unwanted effects. Surface treatments generally fall into three categories: absorbers, resonators, and diffusers. Absorbers, also sometimes called traps, are designed to capture and dissipate specific frequencies. One of the most common acoustic treatment absorbers is polyurethane acoustic foam. The foam is a sponge-like porous material, with open cells that trap the movement of air molecules and thereby inhibit reflections and subsequent reverberation. Figure 1.9. Acoustic foams, like all such porous treatments having small surface openings, generally offer absorption only to frequencies in the upper part of the human hearing range. Thus, while acoustic foam wall treatment can help attenuate the high frequencies that contribute to a bright reverberant sound, it will do little to eliminate boominess at lower frequencies. To absorb sound at the lower portion of the audio range, larger traps, sometimes called bass traps, may be needed. For many years, bass traps were designed on a model pioneered by Hermann Helmholtz. This device became known as the Helmholtz resonator. It is a chamber with a narrow throat, which resonates at a specified frequency, based on the chamber's volume. An easy way to envision how the Helmholtz resonator works is to picture what happens when blowing across the opening of a bottle partially filled with water. When liquid is drained from the bottle, the volume of air in the bottle increases and the frequency of resonance drops in pitch. The bottle has a resonant frequency that is predictable based on its volume. To build a bass trap based on the Helmholtz concept, a large chamber with a small opening is constructed. In many control rooms, this is achieved by building a false wall in front of the rear wall. The false wall can be slotted to allow sound waves to enter the chamber between the walls. Varying the width of the slots permits a range of wavelengths to enter the chamber, as illustrated in Figure 1.10. The cavity is normally lined with absorptive material so that acoustic energy from low-frequency longer waves trapped in the chamber would be dissipated. Rather than resonating, the cavity catches and eliminates the lower frequencies. To be precise, this design should be called a Helmholtz absorber, rather than a resonator. Nowadays, mass-produced sound control products are readily available to treat low-frequency resonance. Commercially produced bass traps are manufactured from polyurethane foam, which is denser than high-frequency foam, and is cut into shapes known as anechoic wedges. Placed in corners, these products can dramatically reduce low-frequency reflection, Figure 1.11. Resonators also often find application in tuning listening environments. A room with small dimensions may not have sufficient volume to allow low-frequency waves to fully develop. As seen in the previous example, a room 20 feet long will have a resonant frequency of about 56 Hz. Of course, frequencies lower than 56 Hz will exhibit even longer wavelengths. Those waves will not become fully developed in a room with a length of less than 20 feet. The result would be compromised low-frequency response below 56 Hz. To compensate, a series of resonators with no absorptive material can be installed to reinforce low frequencies. Diffusers are used to inhibit reflections by breaking up parallel surfaces and causing waves to scatter in different directions. This will reduce room resonances and discourage other undesirable acoustic phenomena such as flutter echoes and excessive reverberation. Diffusers are often the first remedy applied to a problem room as they may reduce the need for absorbers. To achieve diffusion, the wall surfaces must be broken up by eliminating a single, large surface plane. One simple method for creating diffusion is to apply strips or blocks of wood of varying thickness and width to the wall surface. This changes the topography of the wall from a flat plane to an uneven surface. A second type of diffuser incorporates hemispherical or cylindrical shapes attached to the wall surface, which will scatter the reflected sound waves in many directions, as illustrated in Figure 1.12. Some commercial products use absorbent tiles to achieve the same effect, Figure 1.13. Trends in studio and control room design come and go. How surface treatments and acoustic design principles are applied change with the times as well. Before the 1960s, the conventional wisdom was to make studios as acoustically dead an environment as possible, virtually eliminating any kind of reverberation. Studios and control rooms were lined with absorptive materials such as thick drapes that left the rooms utterly devoid of reflected sound. But this type of environment is often uncomfortable for a listener. People are accustomed to receiving cues about the size of the listening space by hearing sounds reflect from the walls, ceiling, floor, and other surfaces in the room. A completely absorptive space does not provide those cues. For a time into the 1970s, control rooms were designed with the front, the end where the monitors are located, being more live, or reflective, and the back, behind the listener, being dead. The surfaces on which the monitors were placed were hard and flat, usually wood or stone, and were located adjacent to the large hard surface plane of the windows. The back wall of the room incorporated a number of traps to discourage reflections. The idea was that sound reflected to the back of the listener's head would adversely affect the accuracy of the listening environment. By the 1980s, one control room design had completely reversed that scenario. A design known as live end dead end lead emerged. In lead design, the front of the room was completely absorptive to theoretically discourage any temporal smearing that might result from sound waves that were bouncing off the hard surfaces surrounding speakers before traveling to the listener's ears. The rear of the room was live, or reflective, to bounce some of the sound back to listeners' back. But the lead design fell from favor just as quickly, and contemporary trends are toward a more moderately reverberant space that enhances a listener's ability to localize sound sources accurately. Summary. Sound exists as vibrations, whether originating in the vocal folds of the larynxes in speech, the strings of a piano when struck by the hammer, the reed of a woodwind as air is forced through, or the head of a drum when struck by a stick. The molecular activity of sound waves can be extremely intricate, with movements occurring at various frequencies and amplitudes. Knowing this, the reader already has an idea of the best way to regulate the behavior of sound within an enclosed space. One must control vibrations. This is the basis for a science called acoustics, the name given to the study of the behavior of sound. It is this understanding of molecular movement that enables audio engineers to make devices that convert these vibrations into electronic signals and to make other devices that convert electronic signals back into sound. Ultimately, too, this knowledge provides an understanding of how listeners hear or interpret sounds, a field of inquiry known as psychoacoustics. These and many other topics will be explored in subsequent chapters of this book.